Welcome, Mark. We wanted to talk a little bit around app modernization and IBM. And I guess probably the best place is really kind of give us a definition. What does IBM think of app modernization is, and is that different than what other people might have an idea that it is?
I think it's a pretty standard industry definition. You know, IBM puts their own little flair, but really app modernization is defined as kind of transforming and updating your software applications to do various number of things, whether it's for scalability purposes, for security purposes, but really it's the discussion around the transformation to cloud and hybrid cloud, that transportability, the containerization of applications, being able to run them very quickly, securely, and anywhere that you do business.
Okay, so really it's kind of from what the application does, really we're not trying to change that, because obviously changes to a user isn't necessarily the best thing. What we're trying to do is change it on the back end on how it runs and give us the flexibility to run it wherever is most efficient, most secure, change capabilities and do that without having these, you know, month-long, year-long design cycles that we have with traditional monolithic applications.
Yeah, that's right. So if you want to look at like the drivers and the benefits to application modernization, it's really about accelerating digital transformation. Obviously, when COVID hit, it really thrust the entire industry into you know, digitizing applications, working from home, having multiple clients, cell phones, laptops, all accessing instead of, you know, workplace, things like that. Modernization also provides a superior developer experience, right? So as you're modernizing your business and you want to gain a competitive advantage, you want to supply your developers with the most state-of-the-art tools and applications that they need to give you a competitive advantage. And finally, deploying enterprise applications, right? So we'll talk here about the timeline, about how we went from a monolithic to now, but deploying those enterprise applications across hybrid cloud. So where does it run most efficiently, securely, whether you need it for scale, and ultimately what the cost advantage is to doing this as well.
All right, so I got to pick on IBM when you said monolithic application, because historically that's kind of where I remember IBM. So, yeah. You know, IBM was the, you know, you bought this hardware stack that ran a software stack. All of it was IBM end to end, and that was the way you did business for years and years.
Yes.
So to see them as now kind of on the lead of modern application development, it's kind of really interesting. So why don't you tell us a little bit more about what that journey has been like?
Yeah, absolutely. So of course, IBM, you remember the mainframe, but we started in this traditional space where everything was monolithic, run on single server environments. You think about your SAPs, your enterprise databases. And then we started to journey, I'd probably say maybe the 2000s and then 2010. We started getting basic when service-oriented architecture came about, introducing multiple different databases to enhance that enterprise database, right? We're bringing in not just the SAP and the sales and things, but you know, the HR overlay and things like that. And we started introducing virtualized environments. And then we went from there into enhancing with application performance management. And then DevOps started to creep in, mm-hmm. as we got. So continuous integration, continuous delivery, you know, started to be a thing. And then kind of where we are today, and which we call the advanced or modern application, which is API centric, mm-hmm. right? Businesses want to expose their APIs, they're monetizing their APIs. You have data lakes instead of everything being really monolithic. Everything's spread out, available, accessible, containerization, and DevOps is a true business entity.
So when we talk about the development process for modern application, really one of the big things, and this is your comment about DevOps, is it's an ongoing process, but it has to start somewhere. So if IBM is working with a partner, with a customer to help them, you know, modernize a line of business application, What does that process look like? What steps do you need to go through to really turn something into a modern application?
Sure. I think it's important for organizations to first assess their current application stack, right? You want to identify what are your traditional applications, like what we saw there, the monolithic applications. What are what we call composite applications, which might be very similar to that enterprise database with potentially cloud-native applications wrapped around that, that support that, and then your true cloud native, potentially already containerized applications. So you want to take an assessment of what you, what the low hanging fruit and what would be easiest to start executing this plan. Ultimately, you want to modernize incrementally. Too many times businesses get in the case of starting to modernize, getting the application starting to go, but then adding things, right? They never fully set a deadline or an endpoint. They're constantly adding and improving applications, but that comes with time and cost, especially. And then your DevOps complain and things like that. So it's very important to assess and then modernize incrementally and also embrace that DevOps culture, right? Embrace microservices, containers, automation, especially, right? When you think about that, there should be no human interaction between the point where you're building your application and then ultimately deploying them. You know, that should be really an automated process. Things like when they go to make code changes, commit in GitHub, and that application is then automatically pushed out into the system. So you should really embrace, you know, kind of that DevOps culture and really empower your DevOps team.
It's kind of interesting because you almost had a contradiction there, because when we talk about modern applications and DevOps, it is this ongoing development cycle, but you kind of put a transition point in there that I don't think a lot of people necessarily think of is, yes, DevOps is where you want to be. You want that continual development. You want those continual improvements and those sort of things, but you have to get to the point to where you're over that hurdle already. I'm trying to think of a good parallel, but the closest thing I think of is, you know, it's, you know, whether any kind of physical move, you know, until you've actually moved into your new house or your new office or whatever, you're always going to go back to the old office.
Right.
So, you know, not only you need to move into the new office, need to get rid of the old office, so you can't go back there. Mm-hmm. So you got to kind of make that initial transition, say, okay, this application is on the new architecture. Now we can look at doing things with it and not get into the scope creep issues with that initial transition. Let's get over there first. Once we've made that move, then we can start look at future improvements.
Right, absolutely. And I was reading an article or a thread or something that said, kind of a naive question or a novice question, why do businesses come out and say, oh, you know, we tried to do this application, but it cost us $103 million. Like, how does that actually work? And how does that happen? Well, obviously, you're paying developers and things like that, but you do get that scope creep, where you're constantly trying to improve it, but you never set that deadline or endpoint and say, okay, this is the line that we're drawing in the sand. This is where it's going to be completed. We're going to start using it as we should. Mm-hmm.
And I think actually that's one of the challenges that a lot of organizations have with any kind of transition, whether it's cloud or hybrid or whatever, is that they don't set a solid target. What does it need to do as of such and such a date? Right. And then we can make things different and changes, but we need to get to that transition first so we can get rid of all of the legacy stuff, which honestly drives a lot of those ongoing costs when you're perpetually in that transition mode.
That's right. You know, with one of the big pushes was like SAP Rise, mm-hmm. and everything that's going on there. So people are, businesses are, you know, continue to pay things like maintenance costs on a lot of these legacy applications or legacy hardware and applications that they can move to a more efficient and cost-effective solution using application modernization.
So let's talk about efficiency. One of the things that we talked on early with app modernization is the idea of transport, being able to transport. So whether, you know, traditional on-premises infrastructure, cloud infrastructure, and in a lot of cases, actual architectures that we're running on. So why don't we talk about a little bit of what IBM brings to the table in terms of that actual architecture?
Sure. So if for those familiar with IBM Power Systems, right, you might be familiar with your traditional IBM i or AIX workloads. You probably might even know that IBM runs, or IBM Power runs Linux as well. But really, IBM Power Systems is the, frankly, premier architecture and infrastructure to run these modern applications and containerized workloads, right? So you have multiple benefits coming from the IBM Power portfolio and the Power servers, like flexible and efficient consumption, right? IBM has a model where you can utilize on-demand CPU capacity, share capacity amongst multiple servers, and ultimately, you'll be able to achieve more performance per core with x86, something around 34 times the throughput on a E1080 versus x86. And then everybody should know that the IBM Power platform is really built around RAS, which is reliability, accessibility, and security. So IBM has a really great platform to develop modern applications on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's one of those things. I mean, we started with the IBM monolithic approach way back when, but that actually built the architecture, for lack of a better way to put it, to the idea of, well, we've got systems that will just keep working.
Yeah.
You know, that's the classic. That's why people still run a lot of IBM Big Iron, a lot of IBM mainframes, is they just keep working.
Absolutely.
And that expertise has led into the developments in Power and brings a lot of those efficiencies, some of the inherent securities, the flexibilities. And once we've moved that application, we're not locked to an architecture.
Right.
So,
you know, one of the good things about IBM Power is you can run your traditional IBM i and AX workloads, mm-hmm. but, you know, the platform is powerful enough and the architecture is built so you can also surround that with modern applications on the same box, right? You tend to, IBM likes to call it, put gravity to your data, right? If your data resides on the box, why not mm-hmm. do modern applications, advanced analytics right on the box itself, where the data resides, where everything's taking place. So it's not like you have to go out and buy new hardware, especially if you're running Power now. But like I said, Power is one of the premier platforms for running modern applications.
And a lot of people are using, if your line of business applications are those IRP series, traditional AIX type applications, being able to run those in parallel makes that, because really the first step in modernizing a lot of those applications is just providing modern access to those traditional applications. And so it sounds like you've got a great platform for that. And then beyond that platform to move forward to eventually get off of some of that real legacy type infrastructure.
We touched on that about paying maintenance on some of that stuff. Some of the statistics around the infrastructure savings, right? Obviously, mm-hmm. you're going to save. Going with Power Systems, this is a Forrester study that we're showing about using IBM and Red Hat solutions together, saving on TCO, decrease hardware costs overall, because IBM Power System allows you to do more with less, right? With resource utilization, you can see 30% optimized resource utilization. And another thing is reduced licensing costs when it comes to IBM Power, because you don't need loads and loads of cores mm-hmm. On IBM Power like x86 does.
So what else can you tell us about app modernization and IBM Power? Is there anything else really that we need to know that really is why our partners should be looking at Power and should be looking at modern apps?
Well, I read a statistic the other day that said somewhere upwards, maybe 89% of businesses either have full-blown application modernization all the way back to starting to explore application modernization. So it's out there. It's available. Mm-hmm. We saw an earlier slide that the combined annual growth rate being, I think it was 29%. So there's opportunity that's out there. End users need application modernization to gain a competitive advantage. What we're looking to do is help that application modernization journey by offering a Power platform along with Red Hat, OpenShift, and things like that.
All right. Well, thank you very much for your time, Mark.
Thank you.